Tara, and today we're going to be talking about fragrance basics. So this is sort of like an introduction to perfumes and some of the key vocabulary that you'll hear when you listen to people review different fragrances or describe them, whatever it might be. So in this particular video, this first one, I'm going to focus on the different concentrations of fragrance, the sort of notes that make up fragrances, and then the vocabulary that people use to describe the performance of a fragrance. So those are the main things I'm going to focus on in this video. Again, this is kind of the basics. And then my goal is for this series of sort of educational type videos to add a little bit more complexity and get more specific as we go on. So this first one's more of an introduction. Some of you might already know everything I'm about to talk about. Some of you might not know very much, but hopefully all of you will learn at least one new piece of information from watching this. So I'm going to start with the lowest concentration and then work up to the highest. In general, as we work our way up, you would expect to see increases in price and also hopefully increases in the longevity of the fragrance, how long it lasts on your skin. But it's not always the case. And the other thing I want to say before I start into these is that these can be kind of subjective. So the percentages I give you of the concentrations are common, they're kind of typical, but any brand can decide that they're gonna slap the name Eau de Parfum on something, and there's not really any regulation to say, no, that's not, this is actually an Eau de Toilette, that kind of a thing. So just be aware, these are general guidelines, and I would assume most fragrance houses, especially the niche ones, follow these guidelines for the most part, but there's not really any system of regulation to say you can't call that this and that. So the lowest level of concentration is typically between 1 and 3%. And in this sort of category, there are several names that are used. I would say traditionally, these would be things called aftershaves. And I know this will shock you, but I don't own an aftershave. However, my husband owns many, so I just grabbed one of his. This one is called Epsilon, and the name of this particular fragrance is Blue Mediterranean. I don't like this, but this just kind of gives you an idea. Aftershave is kind of a traditional name for this concentration level, but also body mists, I'm sure you all are familiar with, things like splashes, or sometimes occasionally you'll hear it referred to as an eau fraiche. Those would be in that lowest level of concentration, and the performance, or I should say the longevity of anything in this category is probably gonna be pretty short-lived. It's really variable, so I'm not gonna give you specific like lengths of time to expect, because there are some really low concentration fragrances that I've used that last quite a while, and there are some that have really high concentrations that don't last very long. So because that's so subjective and particular to a given fragrance, I'm not gonna give you specifics, but in general, if you use a body mist, as I'm sure you're aware, or an aftershave, it's not gonna last very long on the skin. The next concentration is typically about 3 to 5%, and this is going to be called Eau de Cologne. And a lot of times I think people get this confused because in general, at least in the United States, we tend to refer to all men's fragrances as cologne and women's fragrances as perfume, and that is completely wrong. Most men's perfumes are not Eau de Colognes, actually. They're going to fall in the next two categories that I'm going to talk about, just as most women's fragrances are not perfumes or parfums. So let's kind of talk about this one. So Eau de Cologne, again, 3 to 5, still going to be pretty short-lived. One brand that is kind of notorious for a very short longevity of their fragrances is Jo Malone. And I love many Jo Malone fragrances. So this one's Wood Sage and Sea Salt. I'm also a really big fan of Myrrh and Tonka. And the reason why I own those two in particular is because they do last a little bit longer, but I also love the way they smell. However, I love the way most Jo Malone fragrances smell. I just can't justify the price of most of them for being Eau de Colognes. I think most people would agree with that. I think most people, if you go and smell a bunch of Jo Malone colognes, you're gonna find several that you really enjoy the scent of, but if you actually try it on your skin, most of them probably won't last very long. Like I said, Wood Sage and Sea Salt does okay on me, like maybe around 4 to 6 hours if I'm pushing it, probably around 4. Myrrh and Tonka tends to last a little bit longer than that, but it's one of their intense ones. It's still a cologne though. In general, yeah, they don't last a long time, and that's to be expected for an Eau de Cologne. It's just that Jo Malone is quite pricey, and so most Eau de Colognes probably wouldn't cost that much or shouldn't cost that much, but hers do. All right, the next two concentrations, I would guess, are the two most popular, and they're the ones that you're going to typically see if you go to an Ulta or a Sephora. The first one is an Eau de Toilette, and an Eau de Toilette is usually going to be between 5 and 15%, probably on average, somewhere in the middle, maybe around 10%, but that's kind of the typical range for an Eau de Toilette. I own many Eau de Toilettes, and in fact, a lot of the really like citrusy types of fragrances, like your Dolce & Gabbana Light Blue, or the Aqua Allegoria collection from Guerlain, those are all gonna be Eau de Toilettes. But one that I have that I picked specifically the Eau de Toilette because I prefer the scent of it is this one from Diptyque. This is Eau Dwell, and it's their vanilla fragrance. And I actually got samples of both the Eau de Toilette and the Eau de Parfum from Diptyque for the Eau Dwell, and there are differences. Now, this is not always the case. Sometimes if you look at a fragrance and it's offered in various concentrations, all those different concentrations might smell pretty similar. Other times, they might have some slight differences, but in some cases, they can be almost completely different fragrances. In fact, sometimes they have completely different note profiles. So that's something you wanna pay attention to. If you find something you like, and like let's say you find an Eau de Parfum that you like, but you're curious about the other concentrations, I would recommend actually trying to get samples of them because it could be that they're similar. It could be though that they're very different. In the case of Eau de Dwell, I preferred the EDT or the Eau de Toilette over the EDP because this one was a little bit softer and smoother, whereas I found the EDP a bit spicier. Now, in general, I think, you know, whichever one you love is the one you wear. I tend to, when I smell the EDT, think it leans a little bit more feminine, but still very unisex, while with the spicier EDP, I think it leans a little more masculine, but again, completely unisex. So that's just kind of my take and why I picked the EDT. I tend to usually go for an Eau de Parfum, which is a higher concentration we'll talk about next, because I like my fragrances to have a decent longevity. But in this case, I preferred the actual scent of the EDT, so I went with that one. So just be careful there. Just because we think about the name of a fragrance being the same, it doesn't mean that the different concentrations actually smell the same. All right, so of course, the next level up is your Eau de Parfum, and this one is going to be 15 to 20%. Usually, again, there's no strict regulation, but that's kind of a typical range for an EDP. And the one I wanted to show you, because this one has a very famous higher concentration counterpart, is Maison Francis Kurkdjian's Baccarat Rouge 540. Or MFK BR 540 is how it's usually abbreviated. And this one is available as an Eau de Parfum, which is what I have, but also an Extrait de Parfum, we'll talk about next. I don't have that and I haven't smelled it, so I cannot compare them for you, but I just kind of wanted to give you an idea that oftentimes you can get a fragrance, not just in an Eau de Toilette versus an Eau de Parfum, but also in a Parfum or Extrait de Parfum concentration. So again, because this has a higher concentration of about 15 to 20%, this typically should last longer than any of the previous concentrations we've talked about, but I have many fragrances that are EDPs that don't last very long. So again, just realize that this is all subjective. Like the very lowest concentration, the highest concentration of fragrances also have many different names they go by. The two most common that I see are just Parfum or Extrait de Parfum, or sometimes it's like Perfume Extrait or Perfume Spray or whatever. There are many different ways in which this is categorized, but basically the two most common are Parfum, that's the most common, and then this new Extrait de Parfum, I think it's meant to make it sound fancier or like more potent, because if you think of like an extrait of something, it's really potent, but it's the same thing. Anything in this category should fall between about 20 and 40%, although I would say the majority fall between 20 and 30%. One that I wanted to show you guys, because I believe all fragrances from this line are Extraits de Parfum, is Deluxe from Tiziana Terenzi. And all, like I said, I think all the Tiziana Terenzi fragrances come in this level of concentration. I will say that the ones I've tried do tend to last quite a while on the skin. And in fact, Deluxe and also Kirka I've owned, I don't have it anymore, but those are ones that I've sprayed and like literally washed my clothes and I can still smell it on the clothing after I wash it. So in some ways that's good because it's gonna last a long time, but also I want it to not be on my clothes after I wash them. So these are really, really long lasting fragrances. But again, it doesn't mean that they necessarily will be. For example, I also own a couple Roja Parfums, and those are also the two that I own. They come in EDP or Parfum, but the two I own are Parfums, and they don't last more than maybe 4 or 5 hours. The actual quality of those Roja fragrances is fantastic, like so beautifully blended and natural smelling, but they don't perform anything close to how the Tiziana Terenzi fragrances perform. So again, I've said it several times, but in general, the higher concentration, the longer lasting it should be, and that's why in theory you're paying a higher price because there's more actual ingredient going into that fragrance, but it doesn't necessarily have to be that way. Okay, the next thing I want to talk about are fragrance notes. And a lot of times I think when people hear notes, they think maybe it's the ingredients in the perfume, but ingredients are different. Ingredients are the actual raw materials like the perfumer's alcohol or like different oils or molecules that might be added to that alcohol to make the fragrance. Now, ingredients can be natural. For example, ambergris is a natural ingredient that comes from whales. They spit it up. It's from their digestive system. And that is incredibly expensive. So guess what? It's not used very often. Instead, there is a synthetic version of that called ambroxan that's what's commonly used. Not all ingredients come in both a natural and a synthetic form. In fact, there are many notes that can be created by ingredients that you cannot get naturally. So that's kind of moving into the idea of notes. Notes are what you actually smell, like the odor. So you might have an ingredient, but it gives off an odor that is the note. So you might have some sort of synthetic molecule that smells like peaches, for example, because you can't get an oil from a peach like you can from a lemon or lime. Obviously, you guys probably are aware you can get like essential oils and have like a bergamot one or a lemon one or a lime one, lots of different citruses, right? Because you can get oils from those. But other fruits, sometimes you can't. And so those have to be created. Those sorts of notes have to be created. So that ingredient gives off an aroma that is like the aroma that comes from those fruits, for example. The other thing I wanted to mention while we're talking about notes is that you will sometimes hear the word accord. And accord basically is a combination of notes, sort of like how a chord, like a chord in music is a combination of notes. In fragrances, if you hear accord, it means a combination of individual notes that make up sort of this fragrance profile. If I were to guess, I would assume that amber is probably the most common accord. And amber is not a note, it is an accord because you can't get fragrance from amber, like good luck finding amber unless you live in like Jurassic Park. But otherwise you can't really get fragrance from that. So it has to be created. And the actual sort of smell that we associate with the word amber is an accord made up of the notes vanilla, benzoin, and labdanum. And I actually kind of struggle with amber. Sometimes, like, if it's in lower concentrations, it's sort of like a base note, and there's a lot of other things going on, it doesn't really bother me. But really, like, really ambery fragrances sometimes can be really difficult for me. I'm gonna guess it's the labdanum because I think that's the part that gives it sort of this animalic feel. Because obviously I love vanilla, and benzoin pretty much sort of mimics vanilla in a way. It has a very vanillic feel to it. Maybe a little bit more resinous. But I think the labdanum is what maybe I struggle with in that amber accord. But yeah, so amber itself is not a note, it's an accord because it's made up of those three notes. Another thing you've probably heard of before when people are talking about notes are the different sort of classifications of notes. So we have top notes, middle or heart notes, and then base notes. And if you think of it like that, it's kind of like what comes at the beginning, the middle, and the end sort of a fragrance. The top notes are the lightest molecularly. So those are the ones that will dissipate the fastest, but they're there like right away when you spray a fragrance. Some really common top notes will be things like citruses, like basically all citruses will be top notes because they're really light molecularly and they will evaporate from your skin pretty fast. Also, most fruits, not all, but most fruits will typically be seen in the top notes. They don't tend to stick around too long, but they'll be there right away. And then you'll also see some herbs, and even occasionally like some black pepper or pink pepper will be in the top notes, but you can see them elsewhere as well. But those are kind of the most common top notes. So after those top notes dissipate, which usually happens in about 15 minutes, give or take, then you get to those middle or heart notes. And these are the notes that kind of typically give a fragrance its unique characteristic. A lot of times this is where you're going to see florals. Like almost all florals are going to either be in the top notes or the mid notes. But you'll see a ton in the mid. So a lot of florals here. Again, you might see some spices in the mid, but I think, you know, your kind of common florals like rose, iris, jasmine, a lot of those are really common in the mid. So after you've been wearing a fragrance for an hour or two, then you're gonna see those base notes emerge. Some fragrances are quite linear and you're gonna kind of see the top, mid, and base all right away, and it doesn't really change much except maybe some of those top notes just kind of fade away. But the ones that have a little bit more character or story to them, you're gonna get this progression. And the base notes, those are gonna be your heaviest compounds molecularly, and that's what makes them last the longest on your skin. So really common base notes that you'll see a ton are vanilla, tonka, musk, all kinds of woods like sandalwood, cedarwood, agarwood. Patchouli is another really common base note. These things give a lot of depth to fragrances and they last a long time on the skin typically. So those are gonna be kind of what you get the majority of the wear. So let's say you have a fragrance that lasts 8 hours on your skin. Those top notes at best will probably only be there for half an hour. Then your mid, again, at best might be there for an hour or two. And after that, you're mostly gonna have those base notes. So even though the mid notes are typically considered the ones that give a fragrance its character, the base notes are the ones that really carry it throughout the life of the wear. So those are some basics about fragrance notes. The last thing I want to talk about today before I go is just a few common words that you'll hear when people are describing the performance of a fragrance. And I think the performance is important. I don't think every fragrance has to be, you know, a super potent and long wearing fragrance. I think that they all have their place, but it's important to understand the words people use to describe the performance because that will help you determine if that fragrance is good for what you're looking for. So if you want something for an office setting, you might not want the really heavy hitting fragrances, so to speak, right? So there are three main words that people use when they're talking about performance. The first one I want to talk about is longevity, and I've already mentioned that several times in this video. Longevity is just like what it sounds. It's how long the fragrance lasts. Now, you could have a fragrance that has a really good longevity, but maybe it doesn't project well. So projection is the next word I wanted to talk about. This is how far away the fragrance can be detected from your body if you're wearing it. Now, I kind of think of it as like a radius around you or a scent bubble. So if I'm sitting here and let's say my husband was 6 feet away from me, if he could smell that, that's a pretty good projection 6 feet away. A lot of fragrances aren't gonna project that much. Maybe they're more of an arm's length, so maybe like 3 or 4 feet away. Some will be more skin scents, as they call, where they sit really close to the skin, so somebody would have to be very close to you to be able to pick them up. But that's what projection is. It's basically like if you think of like a force field around you, is that something that's really close to you, like a skin scent, or is that something that is kind of really making this big bubble around you with this big radius? Now, projection and the third word I wanted to mention, sillage, I think are the two that get confused the most. I think most people understand longevity, but if you're kind of new to fragrances and listening to or reading reviews of fragrances, I feel like sillage and projection often get confused. Sillage is not projection whatsoever. You could have something that projects, you know, very minimally, like I said, a skin scent, but it could have a really great sillage. Likewise, you could have something that's a huge, like a beast mode projection type of fragrance that has almost no sillage. What sillage is the scent trail, or basically what's left behind after you've left a place, left a room, whatever it might be. So let's say I'm in this office filming and then I get up to, you know, go downstairs to get a snack or something like that and I come back. If this room smelled like the fragrance that I'm currently wearing when I came back, that would be incredible sillage because it's lasted in the room long after I've left, right? Likewise, maybe you can think of a friend that wears a perfume that's, you can tell they've been in the room because that room smells like them, that perfume probably has a pretty good sillage. Whereas other perfumes maybe don't do that. So once that person's gone, you can't smell them anymore. There have been times when I've been very thankful that certain fragrances don't have great sillage because maybe, you know, you're in line behind somebody and their perfume is too strong. And so it kind of gives you a headache, but then as soon as they walk away, it's better, it's gone. Well, that means that it did not have great sillage, but maybe it had really strong projection. So hopefully that kind of clarifies for you the difference between sillage and projection, because they are very different things. Do I think that any one of those characteristics is more important than the others? No, not really. I think, like I said, it depends on what you're looking for in a fragrance. You might want something that is really short-lived because you like to change your fragrances up. Maybe you want something that has low projection, that's really kind of a skin scent because you're going to be in an office setting, or maybe you're going to the gym and you don't want to like choke people out when you're working out, because there is nothing worse than being on a treadmill next to somebody who's got on like a super potent fragrance. I can't take it. And I love fragrances, but I can't take that. or maybe you do want something that projects. You want to make a statement. You want to catch somebody's attention. Maybe you want to linger in somebody's mind, so you're looking for a really great sillage. It just depends on what you're looking for. But those are the three main terms that you're going to hear when people talk about fragrance performance. So I think it's important to know what they mean. That way you can make an educated decision as to what fragrances would be good for your particular need. So that's it for my first installment of Perfume 101. I hope that you enjoyed this video and also hopefully learned at least one new thing. But I do know that many people who watch my videos are also really into fragrance, and some of you guys know way more about it than I do. So if you didn't learn anything, I hope that you still enjoyed watching it. But like I said in the beginning, as I move through the series, I would like to get more detailed. I definitely want to cover different perfume styles and give examples of those. Also, like maybe even individual notes with some examples in case you're interested in certain notes. And then also I definitely want to do some videos on olfaction, like our actual sense of smell. Because as some of you know, I have a master's degree in psychology, and so that's incredibly interesting to me. I specifically studied memory, so not therapy and not sensation and perception, which was what olfaction kind of typically falls under. But memory is, as you know, highly associated with your olfaction, your sense of smell. And so I've always found that particularly fascinating. And so I definitely want to do some videos on that as well. If you guys have any suggestions or ideas of topics you would like for me to cover in this Perfume 101 series, definitely leave me a comment down below, because I'd be really curious to hear the things that you guys are interested in learning about. And then I can kind of create some content around that. But otherwise, I really do hope you guys like this video. So give it a thumbs up. Consider subscribing if you haven't already. I would love that. And thank you guys so much for watching. I'll see you next time. Bye.